Hi, I'm Sarah Maurer, and today I'm going to tell you about the similarity between biological organisms and how that relates to the origins of life. We use what's called a top-down approach, and in this approach, we examine all living organisms and the commonalities between them to better understand what the requirements are for first life or the origins of life. The first thing that all living things have in common is that we use L amino acids in our proteins, and we use D sugars in our sugars and in our nucleic acids. This was first discovered a very long time ago when scientists took purified forms of biomolecules, placed them into a container, and saw how they rotated polarized light. When they rotate to the left, they're called L molecules, and when they rotate to the right, they're called D molecules. And you can see that the molecules are mirror images of each other between the left-handed version and the right-handed version. The next thing that all living organisms have in common is that they use membranes to separate themselves from the environment. And these membranes are composed of amphiphilic molecules, which have a hydrophobic head, a hydrophobic tail that aggregates between itself, and a hydrophilic head group that interacts with the water phase. This creates a barrier to the environment, and it also helps to keep important molecules inside the cell. Membranes are used to separate cells from one another. They're also used to separate organelles from other parts of the cell. One organelle is the nuclear membrane, which separates the nucleic acids from the cytosol in eukaryotic cells. So you can see that in this picture in purple. And the nucleic acids are another component that all living things have in common. The small chemical structures that you see here are very highly conserved between all nucleic acids. They're composed of a phosphate, a sugar, and a base. And DNA forms into these secondary structures like the double helix. But RNA, ribonucleic acid, can form into a variety of other secondary structures. So there is some differences in nucleic acids and how they pack. But there's also a large difference in the size of the genomes of different organisms, so how many nucleic acids an organism will have. The smallest genome is 2.25 million base pairs, the smallest known genome. And the largest known genome is 149 billion base pairs. And so there's a huge difference in how much nucleic acid every cell has. Proteins are also something that all living things have in common. And proteins are kind of like the tool that the cell uses for all of its processes. So for catalysis of enzymatic reactions, for regulation, for transport, proteins are going to be essential to this. All proteins are composed of the same 20 amino acids, and these fold up into a tertiary or quaternary structure that you can see here. The connection between proteins and DNA is called the central dogma, where DNA can replicate itself, but it can also be transcribed into RNA, and that RNA can then be used to make more protein. All cells use this process to build proteins, and all cells are going to use DNA as the information that is designed to tell the cell how to make more of itself. If you deconstruct the proteins that are used in the body or the DNA that is used in the cells, you can build what's called a phylogenetic tree. There are many different ways to construct these trees. You can use proteins, you can use DNA, you can use some combination or other nucleic acids to construct phylogenetic trees. And when you do that, you can build a tree that almost always is rooted between bacteria and archaea, as you see here, with eukarya breaking off from archaea sometime later in the future. And animalia, which is where humans exist, is a small branch in eukarya. When you look at the mineral gene set of all organisms, you can see that a large portion of these genes is related to the central dogma, transcription, translation, ribosomal proteins, about 15%. Other conserved features are in the metabolic component, where we generate energy from either sunlight or from chemical energy in sugars. One of the things that makes our job much harder is that it's not always as simple as comparing two things, and that's because of what's called horizontal gene transfer. And horizontal gene transfer, portions of genes or full gene sets or clusters of genes can be transferred between two organisms. And then those organisms become more fit in their environment and create a new branch on the tree. And so in this right-hand picture, you can see that horizontal gene transfer occurs between all domains and that it has kind of muddied the waters a bit as in terms of the origins of life. And so it may look more like a multi-rooted tree than a single-rooted tree when we actually do phylogenetic comparisons.